So, Jim, how are we doing the start of this episode?
Right, we're just going to keep it simple, sensible, just get on with it.
Hang on, no sketches?
No, we haven't got time to be messing about with any of that stuff. We've got so much coming up for this episode.
Okay, fair enough.
Good. Let's do it.
Coming up, Mark Shinn talks about board design.
Photographer Jason Walcott gives us an insight into life in Indo.
Roberto Ricci answers your questions.
We catch up with AWSI Rider of the Year, Damien Leroy at Surf Expo, and wrap up the latest news. Hadlow, Light, Barrett and Co. fill us in on the Rhosneigr Park Jam.
We announce the winner of the Shinn Toy Boy and launch the F1 Acid competition.
UK wake stylers take over Move of the Month.
Plus lots more. Right, well, clearly we're pushed for time. So, in August, we went to Tenerife, we saw Mark Shinn, and we spoke to him about how he goes about board design. Fast enough?
Excellent.
So, this is the SuperShinn, which is a brand new board in our lineup for 2012. And this board was born from my desire to make a board that's as easy to ride as the Monk and as fun to ride, but has the kind of performance you're looking for to do all kinds of freestyle tricks, whether that's wake style or big air freestyle. And to do that, we developed a new technology in the tips here, which is called HydroFlow. It serves several purposes, the key ones of which were to redirect the water flow over the fins, letting us use smaller fins for the same amount of grip. To increase the rocker around the fins without affecting the rocker through the center of the board, and to increase the amount of pop by stiffening the tail torsionally, but not making extra stiffness from tip to middle of the board, which is really a pretty vital factor in comfort. And I think it's a very, very relevant board for most riders because it's bringing what would normally be hardcore freestyle performance into a board that's simply easy to ride and a lot of fun. And it doesn't matter how choppy the conditions are or how difficult the board is doing all the work for you, and you can just concentrate on getting on with your tricks. Classical shaper, you have someone like Joe from Delight who's been shaping his whole life and feels his shapes, whereas I need to take the feeling that I have, it's more quantitative. I take the feeling that I have on the water and I try to convert that into some numbers and to some curve radiuses and some flex numbers to make progress. It's a different way of doing it. I think in surfboards it's much harder to design like this. It's because surfboards, it's much harder to put numbers on it because every rider is different. And in surfing, you know, if you take the top 32 surfers in the world, they're all riding different boards. So they can't agree. So it would be hard for it's very hard for a shaper to say, this is better than this. It depends so much on your technique and your style, and surfing is such a personal thing. This is Aku Shaper, and this is the software we use to shape the surfboards and send them to the factory. This is one of the two or three pieces of standard surfboard shaping software. And here you can see the finished board. I've got my nice calendar
and all. Classic shaping room.
Yeah. So this is the board that you tested yesterday. This exact file goes to China and comes back like that. So this is the board that was shaped by Joe and is the final custom board that we've approved for production and measured and put into the Aku file and sent to China. And this is the first prototype back from the same file, and it's good, huh? It's amazing how you can send a digital file and have a board back that's so similar.
Jason Walcott has long been a contributor to surf magazines and his work regularly appears in Kite World galleries. Super easygoing, always producing great images, he's a favourite working partner of the likes of Ben Wilson, Rio Stevens and Ian Aldridge.
Now, a move from California to Indo 4 years ago has allowed him to experiment more with his artistic side. So in this profile, we look at some of his best action shots and find out where to find some good food on Bali. Yum.
I'm Jason Walcott. I'm 36 years old. I'm a photographer and I'm originally from Ventura, California. I moved to Bali 4 years ago and I'm so stoked here.
It's like living in a dream.
Yeah, I moved to Bali just for kind of a fresh start on life and try something new. And I've been here since 2008 and it's just been an amazing experience the whole way through. I love it here. No, Indonesia is just an amazing place to travel to. It's really warm and friendly most places, and the people are great. The food's amazing here. I mean, if you like Asian cooking and spicy food, this place is heaven.
Yeah, just the amount of cultures and all the intermingling of different people, especially in Bali, it's just mixed cultures and tons of different people. And then you get outside of Bali and you start traveling around and you see just ancient cultures and ways of life that you can't even imagine. You know, people living, you know, really, really poor lives and still having a lot of happiness. It's just a cool place to go.
I'm really interested in shooting other things besides action sports. I'm really into landscape photography and abstract and just trying to show the world from my perspective. And I know that kind of sounds cheesy, but I guess we all see the world differently. And the way that I can show what I see is, you know, capturing it, doing trippy stuff with the camera. I'm really into speed blurs and low light photography and all that kind of stuff. And I try to make that come out in my kite surfing and surfing photography, but most of the time it's just straight action, which is fun, but I really get into the whole shooting stuff that's really beautiful and just a chance to see the world. And that's actually why I got into shooting sports, was so that I could get on these crazy trips and go to amazing, beautiful places and shoot stuff that people just dream about shooting. And fortunately, through kite surfing and surfing, I've been really lucky to see a lot of the world and go some cool places and get to take some beautiful photographs. In this sport, you get to meet so many cool people, and every one of these guys has just a different character and personality, and it's funny because you've got just this cast of characters. It would make a great movie, actually. There's just so many. There's the grumpy guy, there's the happy guy, there's the let's get work done guy, there's the guy that just wants to go surfing and only kite if he has to. You know, there's all these just fun personalities to be around, and I really like that about my job. I get to be around a lot of cool people, and yeah, it's fun. One of the most amazing places in the world for surfing, but I think the secret's out. It's one of the most crowded places you could ever go to for surfing, but the waves are as perfect as it gets, so it makes sense. Kiting here, it's to be honest, it's fairly frustrating. It's not consistent. When we get wind, it's fluky and gusty, and it's pretty good when it's good, but it's not good often. So if you do come to Bali, come here to go surfing and to experience culture, and if you want to throw a kite bag in your luggage, then do it. But it's tough here. But we make it work. We have our days. There's a lot of opportunities to go explore in Indonesia. There's 17,000 islands and a pretty predictable trade wind pattern. And if you get out there and you look, you're going to find a windy spot that has waves, and it's pretty crazy if you go look for it. Yeah, we've got a couple places that we go to pretty regularly, but we're actually starting to break out and find new spots and
go searching, because this place holds.
Yeah, one of my favorite places in Bali is Jimbaran Bay. We go to this restaurant called Ubung, which is this fish market, and you just sit on the beach and you eat the freshest seafood that's just been cooked over smoking coconut husks, and it's kind of a highlight to almost everybody's trip to Bali. If you don't go to Jimbaran, you really kind of miss something. So if you do happen to be here, go check it out.
Jim, I'm bloody hungry after that.
I'm not surprised. Luckily, we've got our own fish restaurants right here on Brighton Beach. Here, try some whelks.
Thanks.
Now it's time for Roberto Ricci, who answered some of your questions when he was here on a UK demo tour. So, Roberto, I'm here with the man behind the iconic Italian brand. I've got my iconic Italian t-shirt on, Valentino Rossi. You a fan?
Fantastic, of course. How can you be a friend of Valentino? Everybody loves him in Italy.
He's a great sportsman, eh?
He's just the best one, really.
So, I have some questions here that we got sent in from Kite World and Kite Show viewers and readers relating to various things. So the first one is from Ross Walton, who says, kite surfing or windsurfing, which do you prefer and why or when?
You know, depending on where you live, realistically. I prefer kite surfing these days just because I live in an area where the wind is very light. So I tend to find myself excuses more and more to go to to the water instead of staying on the on the office. So whenever I go to the beach, you know, it's kite surfing weather, so that's what I normally do, and I prefer to actually spend more time with the given conditions rather than just looking around and driving around to look for the wind for windsurfing. But if I were to live on Maui, for example, for sure I would prefer probably to go kite, you know, windsurfing, because the conditions there are better for windsurfing.
Charlie Wheeler, he says, directionals, twin tips, surfboards, hydrofoil boards, do you think there will be another big shift in boards after that? So what else is in the pipeline, do you think?
For me, I think it's just race board is, you know, a new channel of development, and you know, bigger fins, wider boards, lighter, better efficient profiles on fin designs is really crucial on racing. It's definitely the new avenue to discover and to actually endeavor. This, the next couple of years, we're going to see a lot of different racing design, which are going to be like taking the sport to a new level. Already from 2 years ago to this year, the race board design has been completely changed. And I would say that now with the technology we have on some of the twin tips, you know, this super high technology which we develop with a car manufacturer in the south of Italy, we're able to actually to create super light, super stiff type of twin tip boards, which I think is going to bring, you know, the design of the twin tip boards on a different level as well. You're able to create a thinner, longer board, which still are very stiff, so they're easier for landing, for example, and then don't weigh anything. So when you spin them around, they really are like you have nothing underneath your feet. So I think through technology and through design, I think the new features are going to be coming mostly into twin tip design for light wind or for high performance freestyling and for racing.
So next question, Nikolai Gadzev has offered you some kite fix. He had some spare left over and he's offered it for the repair of your car crash. But I guess it took a bit more than that. What was the damage?
I don't know yet. It's still the car is in the Aston Martin in Rome, so they still have to tell me how much it's going to be. I think it's going to take a little bit more than the kite fix to repair the car. But we're lucky to be, you know, in shape, and nothing happened to us. So the car is pretty much destroyed, but you know, that's how it goes. So much every day. It was just like the restaurant, it was there filming and doing the interview, and I was kind of, you know, let's either try to show a little bit the power of the car. And I didn't have my glasses, you know, so I didn't really see from far away, and that turn was like, well, I couldn't expect it to be so sharp. But luckily I got it on the right, you know, on really the right angle, and just the side of the car was totally destroyed, but the airbag didn't blow up, so it was like a smooth crash.
Could have been a lot worse.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yap the Good says, were you insured?
I was not insured for the damage. Okay. No, I was insured for the third party damage, but not for myself.
Yeah. So you'll be getting the bad news on that soon.
Absolutely.
AJ Coltman
wonders, if you stop crashing expensive cars, will it mean that his RRD kites will get cheaper?
It's not like it doesn't go directly that way. There's no relation between the price of the equipment and the car crash, actually.
Okay, Roberto, final question here. And it's come from a kite show viewer who is apparently called McLuke Gill, who's from Cape Town. And he asks what plans you have for your incredible, amazing, fantastic new South African rider, Luke McLuey. And is he likely to get his own Aston Martin?
I don't think the Aston Martin is the right car for South Africa. I think more the Fiat Panda is the car you want to drive there, because there's a lot of, you know, road to go up and down the coast. So the Aston Martin is a bit too low, so I recommend the
it's
Fiat Panda.
It's comfortable and it's strong.
Yeah, and from 78 is a good year.
Yeah?
Yeah, it's a good car.
That would suit someone like Luke, wouldn't it?
Yeah, excellent. It's pretty small and can fit all the equipment in there. Only one kite and one board, that's all he needs.
He's saying he's a small guy?
Small but strong, eh? The guy is very strong. But he needs all one board, and it's very, you know, it's amazing. 60 knots, 20 knots, one kite, one board.
And one car?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, Roberto, thanks very much. I know you've got another demo to do this afternoon, so we'll let you go. Thanks very much for your time.
So, Surf Expo is the biggest water sports trade show in the world, and it takes place every year in September in Florida, in Orlando's huge convention centre. So you went, Jim, what was it like?
It's pretty full on as always. The biggest brands from the worlds of wind sports, surfing, skating and wakeboarding all come together under one roof to show all their new products to retailers and potential buyers. So the show's crawling with people who are looking for kit. There's also swarming with pro riders and promo girls.
Welcome to Surf Expo. You're watching the Kite Show.
Welcome to Surf Expo. You're watching the Kite Show.
Thanks, Mauricio. Ladies. So the Association of Wind and Water Sports Industries held their first awards ceremony at the show. North were voted Brand of the Year by retailers, and readers of four magazines all voted for their Rider of the Year in terms of who'd given most to the sport. So I caught up with Rider of the Year Cabrina's Damien Leroy on the Kite World stand, hopefully to show you why he came out on top. So Damien, first ever AWSI Kite Boarder of the Year. You've obviously had a fantastic year. Can you tell us about some of your highlights?
Wow, I mean, it's an honor to be nominated and to be here and to take the award. I can't believe it. It's an amazing feeling. The highlights this year, I won a snow kite event. I haven't been on the snow in 10 years.
I don't know if anybody knows that.
Yeah, I used to be a big ski racer, and I came back on and I won the whole thing. So that was pretty exciting on my 10-year-old skis. And course racing has just been, the level's just been going through the roof, and I feel like we've taken it racing boats and pushing for the Olympics and freestyle. I'm still doing it, loving it, and playing with every aspect of the sport. That's what I love.
I think that's probably the reason why so many people voted for you, is just the amount of effort that you put in. You're such a nice guy as well. You always take the time to talk to a lot of people. What do you think's most important for kitesurfing coming up in the next few years that we really try and take care of?
I think remembering that we got to keep growing the sport. We got to get the people into the sport and make it safe and make it enjoyable. You know, we keep pushing all these different directions, which is good, but we got to keep it easy and fun and reasonable for everybody.
May I have your attention, please?
It's nice to know the good guy does sometimes come out on top, Jim.
Right on, Annalise. Now, there's been a lot going on in the world of competitions lately. In June, the Americans dominated the racing worlds in Germany, with John Heineken becoming world champion and fellow Americans Adam Cook and Brian Lake taking second and third on the podium. Actually, 8 of the top 13 riders all ride at the same spot in San Francisco. Read more about why in Kite World issue 53.
Now, the KSB World Wave Tour also kicks off in Mauritius as we're filming this, featuring the world's top wave riders. Keep up to date and pick your own fantasy league team at ksbworldtour.com.
But perhaps the biggest news is that Yuri Zun and Gisela Pulido have taken the PKRA Freestyle World titles. Still only 17, Gisela took a staggering 8th world title in all competitions. But Yuri, that little rascal, got his first in a landmark year. As we stand, he's won every single event with just 2 to go. No one has ever achieved a clean sweep. Good luck to him.
Good luck to him indeed. Now, time for a bit of Brit grit at the Rhosneigr Park Jam, which saw Aaron Hadlow, Sam Light and more of the UK's top riders head to North Wales to hit some sliders.
Ooh. I first went to Park Jam organised by Chris Burke on the Isle of Wight, and never hit a rail before, never been to the cable, never kited on a rail or whatever, but I was into my boots at the time. And yeah, he kind of showed me the way forward really, and after I enjoyed his event, I decided I need to build a small rail. And after I put that out a few times, I just realised that to get the rails out and have a good time, you can't do it on your own. So that's what made me really start the event, is to get some people down to get the gear in and actually have a good time on it. We've got the rooftop that you can see behind us there, sponsored by Kite World. We've got a fresh kicker that I've really made the kick quite mellow on it, so we can use it with a winch and a ski. We've got an A-frame, and I've also got a flat bar, which we didn't actually crack out this year, just because the conditions were good enough to use the other rails. So, I mean, that's kind of like the banker. Even if the weather's nasty, you can get the small one out. Friday, Saturday. Friday, epic conditions. Glamour day at Rhosneigr, that's what we like to call it. Clear skies, 17, 18 knots. Perfect tide as well. It just came up to the middle of the day, just as we put the structures in. Gave us nice flat water. And yeah, the riding was just getting better throughout the day. The girls never hit rails before, by the end of the day, started to style it. And also Ali Reader going big, going gap in that A-frame that I've got, and having to get those gap threes as well. He was on it. Saturday, rainy, but we did have wind. The two boys, Aaron and Sam, came up, and really chuffed that they came to have a little look. And fair play to them, considering the conditions. I wouldn't want to get out of my van and go out, but they went out there and they showed us, yeah, how to do it properly.
As far as riding sliders goes, I just feel it adds a different aspect to kiting. Like, I've been riding freestyle for a long time, and it's nice to mix it up and do something new. It's hard work, sliders, though. It's not easy, like having to build it and put it in the water. You end up finding, is it worth the hassle? But the end result, if you get a good slider and get some really good hits, it's really rewarding.
And it was really cool to hit some rails in the UK. Last night we had the jet ski on the A-frame, or the rooftop just out here, the Kite World one, in the night. It kind of got held up, so I thought we were going to hit it in the evening, but it ended up being right in the night with the lights on it. It was quite hard because it was a little bit sticky going up, so you kind of got pulled off to the side when you first go up there and test it out. And because you can't see the other side, I ended up like face planting my first one. It was pretty big wake up call. So, but after that, I dealt with it and had a really good session. It was fun.
Last episode we launched the Shinn Toy Boy competition. The question was, Mark Shinn was world champion in both the PKRA and KPWT World Tours, but which year was it?
The answer, of course, was 2002, and the winner is Megan Glover. So well done, Megan, your board will be with you soon.
This episode we've got an F1 competition. They've put up their ultra slick acid freestyle board. No question this time, all you have to do is click the like button on our Facebook fan page. We'll be picking the winner before episode 5, so good luck. So, Annalise, you're a bit of a dirty girl, aren't you?
Excuse me?
No, I mean you like it a bit dark side.
Ah, yes, it must be time for our wake style move of the month.
Vote for your favourite on our Facebook fan page.
Hey, what's up? I'm Tom Court. I'm from the Isle of Wight on the south coast of the UK. And my favourite trick is probably a front tail grab to blind. Check it out.
Hi, my name's James Balding, I'm from the UK, and my move is an S mode with a switch hand tail grab. Basically, an S mode is a front roll with a 360 handle pass, meaning that you land back to heel side on the water. The reason I really like this trick is there's so many different variations. You can take it from the front roll, grab it into blind. This instance, I get the front side 360, landing heel side, and that's the S mode with a switch hand grab.
Hi, I'm Sam Light, and I'm from the UK, and my move of the month is back mode 5, which basically is a back roll with a front side 540. It's a really good feeling trick because it's actually quite hard to get the movement right, and I've only recently just learnt it, so still learning and trying to grab it.
What's up, I'm Aaron, currently living on the south coast of the UK in Worthing at the moment. I've been getting into the wake style movement quite a lot, riding boots. The trick that I'm into the most at the minute is basically anything to do with toe side, backside. The clip I chose is toe side, backside 7, which can be done off a wave or a normal obstacle kicker. Basically, you hop to toe side as you take off, pass the bar on the way up, and carry on the rotation around for a 7.
Hi, I'm Dan Sweeney. I'm from Worthing on the south coast of the UK. Here's one of my favourite moves, the back mode. The back mode is basically a hillside back roll with a frontside 360.
Yo, I'm Luke Whiteside from the UK. I'm sharing a crew move here. It's a two-side front roll with a frontside 360. Check it out!
Hi, my name's Ali Barrett and my trick of the month is a nose grab back to blind. To do this trick, you go into it with your back hand on the bar, pop into a back roll and grab the nose of the board with your front hand, and then switch hands and drop back into blind and just throw a cheeky pop out if you want.
Congratulations to Wainman's Hannah Whiteley. She won the Move of the Month competition last episode with a S-bend nuclear grab to blind.
And as always, thank you for watching. We've got so much coming up, we've barely got time to mention it.
Yep, we're starting a homegrown section, so if you've got clips of yourself that you'd like to see in the show, we want to see them. And we also want your music contributions if you make your own music. Thanks to Carl Mathers for his contributions this show.
And I want to do a shout out to Elliot Robbins, who is our 3,000th Facebook fan.
Indeed. He's an RAF man and a dedicated kiter. I don't think a salute would be out of order now. Finally this episode, we start a series that raises its hat to the art of stylish feature-length kite movie making. We begin this series with one of the most significant chapters ever laid down in a kite movie.
Chris, Buster and Shanti of Tron Alone Productions were right in the thick of it in Hawaii, just as kiteboarding really took off in terms of style, and as its major players delivered their most pivotal moments early last decade.
We are of course talking about Lou Wainman's legendary chapter In a Wake. Here it is, enjoy.
So Jim, this episode went okay, didn't it?
Yeah, pretty much. So we're here with Roberto Ricci, who's over
Richie.
From... Richie, sorry.
Okay.
Let's get that right. So, Roberto, and what was your kind of main art?
Oh, that's a nice one, huh?
Yeah, that's a nice one.
So how was it?
Second day on the wakeboard today. It was very exciting.
Yeah?
Yeah, I loved it.
That's cool.
What is funny is that all those years, there's just one guy that has been sort of in touch with me from this world, sending me emails once in a while and just asking about things, and that is Lou Wainman.
The first video, hi. And Lou, it's for me the best rider in the world. And I looking every day the TV with this video, and this is my inspiration.
We'll be right back.
I've just been crowned 3 times British champion. I'm really happy. And I've just found out I've won the move of the month for the kite show. So stoked! Yeah!